What's going on, everybody, and welcome to another episode on Keeping It in Context. And today we're going to do another episode, kind of a mini series that we're doing, of two scriptures that are often taken straight out of context. Matthew chapter 18 and verse 20. For where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. Now, if you have been around Christianity for a while, if you've been in church, you probably have heard this scripture being used, and many times being used to suggest that when there is a few people in a church meeting or in a prayer meeting, that God is there, God is present, and God will be activated. Sometimes you'll probably hear statements like, well, it may not be a lot of people here tonight, but the Bible says that when there's two or three that are gathered, if there's only a few people there, then God will show up. And listen, I throw no stones because I've said these statements before, you know, and it's very easy to make the statement because it just seems like it fits, right? But although it sounds good, although it sounds like the right thing to say at those particular moments, this is really not what Jesus intended when he made this statement. And to really know what Jesus meant, we have to really contextualize this particular portion of scripture. First, let's go back just a few verses and let's see what's the main subject that is at hand. Notice what it says in verse 15. Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. So right at the top, we can see that the main subject here is about how the disciples ought to correct certain people, and mainly believers, because he does mention brother. And so first he says, if there's an issue with your brother, if your brother has sinned against you, then you ought to take him personally and you ought to address the situation. Tell him what needs to be corrected. And if he accepts your correction, then Jesus says that you have gained your brother, or you have helped him to be restored. Then he says in verse 16, but if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. In other words, in the event that the brother does not want to change, that the brother does not want to receive or accept your correction, chooses to continue to do what he wants to do, then what you have to do, Jesus says, is to implement really a principle of a law that is found in the Torah in Deuteronomy chapter 19 and verse 15 that deals with court cases and how to testify against someone. Deuteronomy 19:15 says, one witness shall not rise against a man concerning any iniquity or any sin that he commits. By the mouth of two or three witnesses, the matter shall be established. And so having two or three witnesses present who all agree, right, and attest to the needed correction from that person will be a public validation, if you will, and a conclusion of the matter to which the Lord will uphold. And this is why he says in verse 18, verily I say unto you that whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. I am going to uphold what's being established through the amount of witnesses that are present. And I know sometimes you would also hear this scripture being taken out of context, right? That this binding and loosing means that you can supernaturally bind demons and spirits, and you can create new laws in which God would just, you know, approve you to do. This is not what this text is suggesting here. And of course, we can talk about this scripture at a later, you know, later video. But it's really to talk about the fact that the disciples have the ability to teach, to declare, and to uphold the things that are already permitted in heaven. And so this is really what the scriptures are really saying, what Matthew chapter 18 and verse 20 is really trying to imply here. When you look at the main subject, when you look at the totality of the conversation, you will come to understand that when it talks about two or three gathering together in his name, that's where he will be in the midst of them. It's not regarding a certain amount of people and a specific place in which he can operate. He's really just talking about establishing the disciplines that are going to be administered by the disciples. And let me just add one thing in regards to this this issue of the text, in regards to, you know, the mouth of two or three witnesses. Listen, when it comes to God moving, when it comes to God being activated, God does not need a specific amount of people to be present in order for him to move. Whether there is two or three, whether there is a 5,000, whether it's just one, whether it's just you, if you are a believer, right, if you are spirit filled, God is going to be present with you. God is going to be able to hear your prayer. God's going to be able to enjoy your worship. You don't have to have two or three people to be present in order for God to activate or for his spirit to move among you. God can operate regardless of the number. Okay, so this is why it's important that, you know, we look at these scriptures in its proper context so that we can apply it to our lives properly. All right, the second scripture is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 9. It says, but if they cannot contain, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn. Now, for this text, it's not necessarily that it's taken out of context, but it's more so that there's a word within the text that kind of changes the dynamics of how we interpret the text, and that's the word burn. Many people believe that when Paul says burn here in the text, that he is referring to hellfire, that a person should get married than to burn in hell, in the fires of hell, for sexual immoral acts that are committed. Now, while it is true that those that commit immoral acts are deserving of the fires of hell, the word burn here is not suggesting hell fire. The word burn, according to Strong's Concordance, can refer to either being on fire, being greatly worried, like burning with distress, which 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 29 shows the word burn being used there in that sense, or to be sexually aroused, like to be burning inwardly with passion. So Paul here, when he is saying that it's better for a man to marry than to burn, he's saying that it's better, you know, to marry than to have all these, sexual passions and desires that are unable to be fulfilled. You know, that it's better for you to get married so that you can, you know, release yourself from this great distress of not being able to, you know, satisfy, you know, the God-given nature that's in us to be intimate. He says that's, you know, you should do that. And furthermore, when you actually look at this chapter, even from the beginning, you will see that the main issue that the Corinthian believers were having, that he was trying to address, was the subject on marriage and whether or not one should get married, especially during the time that they were living. It was very stressful, a lot of persecution and so forth. So, you know, Paul says, hey, well, you know what? Let's listen. It's in verse one. I think he mentions that it's better, you know, for a man not to touch a woman, but for the sake of not falling into sexual sin, he says, let every man have his own wife and let every woman have her own husband. So in respect to the text, the context, we can see that when Paul does mention that about the word burn here, it's not about hellfire, but it's really about inward passions for sexual gratification. However, as I mentioned before, you know, doing things that are not in line with God, such as fornication and you know, sexual sin, can, of course, and will, you know, lead you to that particular place. Well, I hope it's been a blessing to you. Hope you learned something different. If you have, just throw some comments below. If you enjoyed the content, like, share, subscribe, hit that notification bell so that you can stay up to speed with all the videos that we'll be dishing out on this channel. Until next time, as you're going to continue to study, just remind yourself But as I'm studying the word, I gotta make sure I keep everything in context.